Good morning and welcome to worship. Thank you for joining us today. We're glad you're here. Today, we celebrate our pastor's fourth year anniversary. We're grateful to God for Pastor E, Lady Aurelia, Ellis, Aniana. God has done great work through our pastor in growing the church, equipping the saints, and reaching the community. As we look forward to many years to come, here's a look back at the past 4 years. Join us in wishing our pastor a blessed fourth anniversary. Visit our website at mountpilgrimlc.org. Connect with us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram at Mount Pilgrim Lake Charles. Join us on the prayer line Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 6 a.m. for prayer with the preachers. If you're visiting with us and would like to become a part of our church family, please make contact with us through the comment section or through our website. As we continue to rebuild the damage to our campus from the hurricanes, many of you have asked how you can help. Well, number one, pray for us. Pray that God will give us favor with the insurance companies and contractors. Two, continue to support your church financially. You can give online or you can drop it off in person or by mail at 119 North Bank Street, Lake Charles, Louisiana, 70601. And thirdly, be patient with us. As we're all rebuilding our personal lives, there will be hiccups and difficulties along the way. But if you do have a need, please contact your deacon. Please continue to practice those healthy habits as we endure this COVID-19 season. Continue to wear your mask, practice social distancing, and wash your hands. And finally, if you need hygiene products, toiletries, cleaning supplies, or clothing, please reach out to us. And those are your announcements for the week. God bless you and enjoy the service.
Good morning, Mount Pilgrim. What a day it is to be in God's house one more time. As we come this morning, we want to welcome all of Mount Pilgrim family that is worshiping with us online, and we want to welcome all of the visitors that's worshiping with us also. Today's a great day. Today's a great day because we first want to give God the praises for everything that he has done and everything that he will do in the future. When we look back at 4 years, we say God has brought us from a mighty long way. If you're a member of Pilgrim, you knew where we were 4 years ago. But God sent us this young, energetic, anointed preacher, pastor, and servant. And we want to put all the emphasis on preaching and pastor and servant, because during the storm, when no one was at church, Reverend Kemper and his family was laboring and serving the membership and the community. So we are so grateful to be able to stand here today and first give God the praises for who he has sent to lead Pilgrim. We thank God for you, Reverend Kemper, and your family. Let us bow our heads this morning. Heavenly Father, we come and we come acknowledging who you are, realizing that you are God and there's no other God without you, realizing that you are our protector, you're our sustainer, you're our provider. And Heavenly Father, you keep us, Heavenly Father, when we don't even know how to keep ourselves. So Heavenly Father, we say, thank you, Jesus. We thank you for waking us up and starting us on a brand new day. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for sheltering us and keeping us till this hour. And then, Lord, as we come, we want to just say thank you, Heavenly Father, for bringing Pilgrim this far. Heavenly Father, we didn't do anything. We was just instruments in the palm of your hands. And then, Heavenly Father, you brought us the Reverend E.G. Kemper. And we say thank you for his leadership. Thank you for speaking through him. Thank you for directing his path. Thank you for implanting your wisdom in his spirit. Then we thank you for the labor of his wife and his children. Then, Heavenly Father, we come right now, Heavenly Father, asking for a blessing upon the preacher that's going to be bringing the word today. Heavenly Father, have mercy upon him. Heavenly Father, work through them in a mighty way. Heavenly Father, work through them that those of us that are saved will be encouraged to run on. And then, Heavenly Father, from those of us that are fallen afar off, would be encouraged to move up front. Heavenly Father, and give him a word for our pastor that encourage him to keep fighting the battle of pastoring. We realize that this battle can be hard sometimes, Heavenly Father, but we believe that you're on his side. We believe that you'll lead him in a path of righteousness for your name's sake. We believe, Heavenly Father, that you would lead him as a shepherd feeding his flock. And then, Lord, we come right now, Jesus. Lord, we ask a blessing upon the sick and the afflicted. Somebody is laying in a hospital, Lord, calling on your name. Somebody saying, the doctor's telling me there's no more hope. But we know that that doctor's just an instrument that you using, Lord, to heal somebody. Lord, somebody's walking around Lake Charles and looking at all the devastation right now, and they're saying, Lord, it seems like we'll never put it together, but we walking around with blindness right now. But if we put our trust in the name of Jesus, Lord, he'll move them blindness now and let us see a great city. Lord, we come right now because you've been good to us. You've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. Lord, when we were lost now, couldn't find our way, Lord, one day you came into our lives and you give us hope beyond our understanding. You give us direction when we was on our way to hell. Lord, we thank you, Jesus, for just being God. Lord, I could have been dead and in my grave, but Lord, you made a way and I was able to see another day. Lord, I thank you, Jesus. Lord, I thank you when my way get dark. You're my light now. Lord, I thank you when the rain fall. You're my sunshine. Lord, I thank you when I'm confused, Jesus. Lord, you're my way maker. Lord, when I'm burdened, you lift me up. Lord, I thank you right now. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. He's my friend. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. He reached way down in the muddy mug and he lifted me. He washed me. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for my salvation right now, Jesus. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I'm not all that I should be. But Lord, I thank you for what I am. Because I remember when you picked me up, I wasn't worried that it'd be anything. Now, Lord, we ask a blessing upon this service. Heavenly Father, we ask a blessing. And even when we come to celebrate Reverend Kemper's 4th year, we want to give you the praise because it was you that made it all possible. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. Somebody give the Lord some praise. Come on, if you know he's worthy, come on and praise him right now. Because he woke you up this morning, he started you on your way. Come on and give the Lord some praise.
And all that is within.
He's done things.
He has done great things.
Has done great things. Everybody lift your voice and say,
hallelujah,
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 hallelujah. Say, Lord, your word,
Lord, your word,
of the glory,
of your glory,
and the honor,
and the honor.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah.
Say, Lord, your word,
Lord, your word,
of the glory,
of your glory,
and the honor,
and the honor.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah.
I can't stop praising,
can't stop praising.
I can't stop dancing,
can't stop dancing.
You've been too good, Lord,
been too good, Lord.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah.
I can't stop praising,
can't stop praising.
Can't stop dancing,
can't stop dancing.
I've been too good, Lord.
Been too good, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Say, Lord, your word.
Lord, your word.
Of the glory.
Of your glory.
And the honor.
And the honor.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I can't stop praising.
Can't stop praising.
Can't stop dancing.
Can't stop dancing.
You've been too good, Lord.
Been too good, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Oh, somebody praise him right now.
Thank you.
Say, you get the glory.
You get
take the honor.
You take the honor.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You get the glory.
You get the glory.
You get the praise.
You get the praise.
You take the honor.
You take the honor.
Thank you.
Thank
somebody
you.
Say thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Everybody sing here. Somebody praise the Lord right now. Come on and lift him up because he's worthy. Oh, he's worthy.
Thank you for being with us this day on this blessed and special day. I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker for the day. He is, like our pastor, a fairly new pastor. He's been at New Sunlight Baptist Church for just over 3 years now and has been doing a fantastic job. He, like our pastor, has been an impact player in this community. So we thank you right now for accepting as I introduce and present to you the pastor of New Sunlight Baptist Church, Pastor Williams.
Amen. Would you bow in a word of prayer with me? God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your presence and your power. And right now, God, as we worship you and as we celebrate who you are and all that you have done, we also celebrate what you're doing through the personality of Pastor E.J. Kemper and his family and this church in this community. And we thank you for 4 amazing and awesome years of pastoral ministry and a partnership with God's people and with you. And we thank you right now. We simply ask that you would allow us to worship you as we have together in spirit and in truth, and that now that we've worshiped in song and we've worshiped by giving our time, we pray, oh God, that we can worship and honor you in preaching. So please speak through me as you've already spoken to me. Allow your word to be in my mouth. This is my earnest prayer, and we ask it in the name of your Son and our great Savior, Jesus, the one and only Christ. And all who agree with me and believe in that said amen. Amen. And well, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we choose to rejoice and be glad in it. I want to thank our brother for the gracious introduction of me, and we want to thank these musicians and this awesome praise team and all who have contributed to making this worship experience what it has been thus far. I want you to know that I give honor to God, we give honor to the Lord Jesus Christ, and we thank God for the presence of His Holy Spirit, who resides within those of us who know Jesus personally, and He governs and guides our time together. And then we thank God for this, the fourth pastoral anniversary celebration of Pastor Kemper. I call him friend and brother and colleague, and I thank God sincerely, and I want to say that publicly to Mount Pilgrim and to all of you who are worshiping with us online, who are beyond the confines of this sanctuary and beyond the confines of this membership. We thank God, this community thanks God for the personality and the pastoral leadership and the ministry of Pastor E.J. Kemper. We also want to acknowledge his wife and family, because we know that they are together on this journey. They walk together. They share both in the joys and the sacrifices. And so this church and this community, we celebrate with you all, Mount Pilgrim, the tremendous leader and servant of God that you have in Pastor Kemper. It's an honor to be here, and I personally and publicly thank him, thank his family, and thank this church family for being so gracious to us. Again, we come from the New Sunlight Church. We're grateful to be here on this day that God has made, and I don't want to delay any longer. I could go on and on about our friendship and our partnership and the laughs that we've shared together, but we have an assignment, and so I do ask that you pray with us as we seek to hear from heaven even now. And so I invite you on this day of celebration, this day of anniversary, to the book of Ephesians. I'm going to be reading from Ephesians chapter 6. It's a familiar passage of Scripture, chapter 6. We're going to commence at verse 18, and we'll conclude at verse 20. Again, this is Paul's letter to the Ephesians, the church at Ephesus, and I'm going to ask that you meet me in the 6th chapter. And I'm going to commence at verse 18, and then we'll conclude with verse 20. Familiar passage for those who may not know. Join me there in the New Testament. I'm going to be reading from the NIV, the New International Version of God's Word, but whatever version or translation you have, please share with us at this time. And here's what it says: "And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me, that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains." And finally, Paul says, "Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should." And on today, I want to preach this anniversary with your prayers and with God's presence from this subject: prayer makes it all possible. Prayer makes it all possible. The renowned 20th century Scottish evangelist and author Oswald Chambers had encountered his own difficulties on the journey of ministry and service unto the Lord, and he had seen the struggles of others who dared to serve God, and as a consequence, he spoke poignantly and with profundity when he said these words: "We have to pray with our eyes on God, not on our difficulties." His statement, Pastor, resonates with me because it acknowledges that life can present some challenges, and life can throw you some hardships, and life can bring some demoralizing circumstances that all and all too often seem impossible to overcome. Yet, this also affirms that we must lift our gaze to the God who reigns over our circumstances, and we must avoid fixating our attention on the discouraging realities of our circumstances. Somebody knows that this is the case because it is only then, as we commit to the discipline of prayer, that we can then be in the right posture and the right disposition, and we can gain access to the power that is necessary to be triumphant even in the midst of tests and trials and of tumultuous living. Somebody besides Pastor Kemper ought to be able to testify that life can present some impossible situations that make our human intelligence and our human ingenuity less than adequate and less than sufficient. And this makes God's divine presence necessary. In other words, life is going to usher in some situations that require more than what we can do as human beings in our limited capacities. And as a consequence, we come to the place, I pray, that we understand that we need God's divine assistance. Scripture reminds us of this, Pastor, because there are myriad examples in which God's people needed and God's servants and God's leaders and God's people needed and were able to benefit from his incredible and awesome assistance when they understood, watch this, the necessity of prayer. Because I said at the outset, all of this is only possible. Pastoring is only possible. Success in ministry, success as a church, pastor and people hanging together, sharing together, growing together, and not splitting up, that's only possible through prayer. Because prayer is our lifeline. Prayer is our communication line. Prayer is our hotline. Prayer is the way in which we can reach God. Before Drake had a hotline, the people of God have a hotline that we can dial up, and God's always listening. Because we have 24-hour access to a divine God. That's what Hannah knew. I'm just going to call the roll real quick. Hannah knew how to pray because the Bible, thank you, Holy Ghost, said that Hannah was so intensely in prayer that her heart and her soul was praying, but and her mouth was moving, but no words were coming out. And the priest, the Bible says, thought she was intoxicated and full of alcohol. But later on, she revealed that she was in prayer because she was barren and she was asking God to bless her womb and open it that she might have favor and might give back the very child that she was praying for. Hannah knew how to pray, but Daniel also knew how to pray. You remember Daniel, don't you? Daniel, the Bible says he had interpretive gifts, that he was a man of wisdom and understanding. But there came a time where all the wise men and the astrologers and all those who pretended and were so-called intelligent men, they could not come up with an interpretation of the king's dream. And so the king got upset and threw a temper tantrum, because that's how folk act when they don't know God. They throw temper tantrums when life doesn't go their way. And he said, I'm gonna kill all the men who are wise men. But the Bible says that Daniel went home and he prayed. He told all his friends, get off Facebook tonight, get off Instagram, get off Xbox and PlayStation, and I want you to get on your knees and say a prayer that God would have mercy on me. And the Bible says that he gave the king his interpretation. Not only did Daniel have prayer and Hannah knew how to pray, but the Bible says the church knew how to pray, because Peter was in jail. Peter was on death row. You remember Peter had been preaching and Peter had been teaching. Peter had been walking with God, and he was a threat to the status quo. So he was incarcerated. He was awaiting his death sentence. And the Bible says that while he was locked up, the church was in earnest and intense prayer on behalf of Peter. All I'm saying is that you and I can't make it through this life, and your pastor can't thrive in his ministry, and your church cannot be triumphant in its ministry, in her witness to this community, unless you remain in prayer. And the one common thread is this insistence on exercising prayer in a time of turmoil, when situations seem to be impossible, and suddenly you find out with prayer there is possibility. Because when you pray, you discover and you are reminded that God is able and he's willing to respond to your prayer. Now somebody can help me right here. Some of us know folk that are able, but they're not willing. And others of us know folk that are willing, but they're not necessarily able. But how many can testify that you know that your God's not only willing, but he's able? He's not only able, but he's willing. And so it's prayer And that's why James says, count it all joy. Consider it all joy, brothers and sisters, when you face trials of various kinds, because you're being tested and your faith is going to have to be one that produces perseverance, and you have to let perseverance finish its work so that you can be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Maturity, a prayer life, a disciplined life, a walk with God requires growth and maturity. And so it's in Ephesians that we see, as we get to the text, that Paul is laying out the sphere of divine activity and the signs which provide evidence of God's presence in our lives. You see, the work of God is localized in the church, but it transcends any geographical location. Watch this, because it is ultimately activity that Paul conveys is happening, here it is, in the spiritual realm. That's what Ephesians is. It's showcasing the operation of the Holy Spirit and why it's paramount for the vitality and the victorious claims of every pastor and every church. We see the marvelous operation of God's Spirit is woven throughout the fabric of Ephesians, because Ephesians says you are also included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, because when you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. It says, through him, through Christ, we have access to the Father by one Spirit. That's that word Spirit again. He says, I pray that out of glorious riches that he may strengthen you with power through what? His Spirit in your inner being. Ephesians also says, make every effort to keep the unity of what? The Spirit through the bond of peace. And here's another one. Don't be foolish, but understand what God's will is. Don't get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery and foolishness, but instead be filled with the Spirit. The Spirit is all over the canvas of Ephesians. And there's a shift, however. There's a shift, Pastor, in tone and in tenor, because Ephesians not only covers our spiritual witness and our walk, but it also includes our warfare. And that's where we find these words. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Paul said, put on the whole armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Can I slide something in right there? You do understand, church, those who are watching and listening, that the devil has schemes. You thought you were bad until you met the devil. You thought you were smooth and shrewd until you came across the devil. Nobody can operate like he can. And that's why you ought to pray for your pastor. And I know this doesn't happen here, but at other churches, I've been places where it's evident there's more gossip going on than prayer. There's more backbiting going on than prayer. There's more lip service than prayer service. And so I'm going to challenge us to continue to pray. Pray for the pastor. Pray for his family. Pray for your family so that God can bless this church. Because listen, you have to have the right wardrobe on if you're going to be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. It's the apparel that we wear. It's this belt of truth and this breastplate of righteousness. And you know it, the shoes or sandals of peace and the shield of faith. Not Wakanda, I like Wakanda, but the shield of faith and the helmet of salvation. But notice that when you discuss the armor, all of those are defensive aspects of the combat. All of that is designed to protect you. But when the text shifts and it talks about the sword of the Spirit, and then it talks about prayer in the Spirit, these represent the offensive aspects of spiritual warfare. And that's what I want to zoom in on right now, that the sword, watch this, and the speech of the soldier are offensive weapons. Here it is, that can, if we're not careful, be very dangerous, because they can be manipulated even by the enemy. Catch this, the word of God and our prayers must be rendered unto God with reverence and humility and focus and concentration, because Satan will try even in your prayers and your proclamation. He'll try in your Bible study and your prayer time. to change your mind and to distract your attention and to divert your focus. And that's why you ought to pray for your pastor, not just on Sunday morning, but pray for him Saturday night, and pray for him Friday, and pray for him on Thursday, pray for him every day of the week, so that his mind stays clear and focused. Because here it is, prayer makes it all possible. I'm almost done, but prayer has made 4 years of powerful preaching possible. Prayer has made 4 years of awesome ministry possible. Prayer has made 4 years of being an impactful church in this community possible. Prayer has made his preaching powerful and impactful, because prayer in the text confirms the reliability of God's power. Check this. Prayer confirms the reliability of God's power. Because we already said prayer is a weapon that's available to use in spiritual warfare. And spiritual warfare defines and describes not only Christian living, but pastoring, because he's up against it. He's up against Satan and his schemes and his imps and demonic presence. You do understand, catch this, you don't have to be demonically oppressed to be demonically influenced. You don't have to be possessed to be oppressed. You can be influenced and swayed if you're not careful. That's why you must be alert when you're praying. And you must be attentive to your prayer life, because the text teaches us pray in the Spirit. It says on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests, because we are equipped through prayer to maintain our spirituality. There's nothing worse than church folk. There's nothing worse than church leaders. There's nothing worse than a pastor. Thank God you don't have one, but I've seen folk in other places, and you can tell that there's not a sincere spirituality that is attached to the activity. I wish you'd catch what I just said, that you can have a whole lot of activity, but is it spiritual? So prayer equips us on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. That means pray whenever you feel like it. Pray whenever you need God, pray to him. And when you're praying about your family, pray for his family. When you're praying about your wife, pray for the pastor's wife. When you're praying about your children, pray for the pastor's children. Pray for them, because that equips them to maintain spirituality. Can I be real with you all? Every now and then, the pastor doesn't want to use the kind of vocabulary that he customarily uses. Let me just testify for me, pastor. Every now and then, I feel like using other words that aren't so spiritual when I get upset when stuff doesn't go my way. But can I tell you something? Every time I've been tempted to use vocabulary that I thought I had thrown away, and don't look at me like you don't understand what I'm talking about. You know what kind of words and what kind of vernacular you have. But when you get tempted, you forget about what you were going to say to folk, and you start talking to God. Anybody here know that you can wave your hand at home, in the kitchen, in the bathroom, wherever you are, in your car, that when you have a talk with God, then he'll change your vocabulary. And what you were going to say to him or her, God can change that thing around. He can tell you, talk to me and I'll deal with them later, but have a talk with me. Because it equips you and I to maintain our spirituality. But it says, with this in mind, be alert. Keep on praying, because prayer is that which requires stretching and strain and struggle. Can I tell you something? Prayer, real prayer, does not always take place in the context of comfort and convenience. I wish you'd help me preach right here. Real prayer is not confined to those times and moments or seasons of life that are full of blessing. Sometimes prayer must happen when you're broken. Sometimes prayer for the pastor must happen when he's praying for your wife and your husband and your marriage, when he's got to go home and work on his marriage, when he's got to pray for your kids and then pray for his, when he's got to pray for your family and then pray for his, when he's got to pray for your financial progress and pray for his. And so it's a struggle at times to pray for other folks' issues. When you know you got to go home and you got to get on your knees with your family and ask God to bless our issues. Because we all have our issues. Make no mistake about it. People forget that the pastor is human. The pastor gets tired. He gets fatigued. He gets exhausted. He gets frustrated. It's a struggle. But prayer makes it all possible. Because it allows us to remain attentive even when we have to agonize through some things that are tough in this life. But I got to move because praying should take place for all the Lord's people. I'm just walking through the text. Text says prayer ought to be for all the people. Paul said when you pray, pray for everybody. You know what I like about that? That takes out, eradicates, eliminates your partiality and your bias. That means you got to pray for the pastor when he preaches what you like, and you got to help me preach right here. You got to pray for him when he gets on your toes and challenges you with stuff you don't like. You got to pray for your friends and your enemies. You got to pray for your church and the church down the street. Pray for all the Lord's people, because when you pray, it confirms the reliability of God's power. Someone here knows that God has power, but you and I unlock that power in prayer. But I'm done, because prayer not only confirms the reliability of God's power, but here's where we finish off, and we're done on today. Prayer cultivates the audacity that is needed for your pastor's proclamation. Prayer cultivates his boldness, his audacity to say what has to be said. You do understand that sometimes, oftentimes, he's got to preach not what he would rather say, but what God has instructed him to say. And sometimes what that is doesn't line up with our preferences, nor does it line up with our time schedules. Sometimes he's got to drive not only into your driveway, but get all the way in your garage and then walk up the stairs and walk into your kitchen and sit down at your table and spend some time with you. And you're wondering, how did he know all that? He didn't, but God's Spirit can reveal certain things. And his word matches your situation, and he don't even know your business. His preaching can speak to your situation, and he doesn't have to know a thing about what's happening behind your closed doors. That's God's power. But that's why you got to pray for him, because he needs audacity. He has to be bold enough to say what other folk are afraid to say. He's got to be bold enough, come on and help me right here, to say what you don't feel like hearing him say. He's got to be bold enough and audacious enough to challenge you, not just comfort you and compliment you. He does that. He'll affirm you. He'll compliment you. But every now and then he's going to have to challenge us. And we got to pray for him, because Paul says prayer cultivates this. How? Paul said, after you get through praying for everybody, pray for me. He said, so that I can fearlessly make known the gospel and pray that I should declare it fearlessly as I should. Because, check this, proclamation requires that God supplies what he says. He says, pray for me that whenever I speak, words may be given to me. See, if you read the Bible too fast, you'll miss something. Paul said, pray for me that whenever I speak, words may be given. Which means that nothing your pastor says, if he submitted himself to God, can be said without the assistance of God. It means that nothing he preaches, nothing he teaches, nothing he sends forth into the atmosphere comes out unless God supplies it. That's power. That when you have ugly looks on your faces, nobody at Mount Pilgrim, but you know, in other places, when he goes and preaches out, he's got to be bold enough. I'm glad you could smile with me today. He's got to be bold enough to say what God has instructed, because God is the one that supplies it. And this is what I love, Pastor, because this, see what this does, more than people realize, this verse, for me, this doesn't remove accountability, but it gives me a sense of hope, and it gives me reassurance, because what it reminds me of is that I'm not doing this by myself. Every time I stand, I know that God is with me, and that everything I'm trying to say, I'm only going to say it through the enabling power of God. So it's God's supply. But look at what the rest of the text says, and we're done. He says, pray that I can say whatever I need to say, that words may be given, so that I can make known the mystery of the gospel. It's a mystery, the mysterious aspect. What is that? That proclamation must be revelatory in substance. That it's not enough to simply rehash and rehearse the stories that you and I are familiar with, but when he preaches, you ought to thank God that he can take the same Bible, the same scripture that you've been reading every week, the same text, the same Bible, and he can have fresh, revelatory substance. Do you realize how profound that is? That every Sunday or every Saturday or every Wednesday, whatever day you gather on, that every preacher preaching Christ Jesus takes the same Bible. Catch this. The same scripture, same Bible, the same chapters, Genesis through Revelation, same book. And everybody can preach from the same book and have different messages. Everybody can preach. He can preach. Catch this. You ought to really shout Mount Pilgrim on this. He can preach one sermon and speak to every situation all at the same time. Now, if you're at home, if you're in your car, please catch this. God can use and does use the pastor to preach one sermon that speaks to every situation all at one time. Because God has a kind of power through his word that he can reveal himself to you in the way you need it just for you. It's like putting on a suit tailor-made to fit. It fits you like no other. God's word through the pastor fits you like no other. It's revelatory in substance. We're done. But he says, make known the mystery. But here's what we end with. Paul says, he ends with this phrase. He says, because I'm an ambassador in chains. Paul said, I'm an ambassador in chains. That proclamation is not only revelatory in substance, something that requires that God supplies it, but here it is, we're done. Proclamation's got to be rendered in submission. Your pastor is operating in submission to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's a heavy dose of reality for some of us if we really take in what that means, because that means that he is not operating in and of himself, that he is not a lone ranger, that he's not gone rogue, that he's never MIA, that even when he's away and out of your sight and away from your presence, God is still with him. That he's still operating under the purview of the Lord Jesus Christ, because Paul said, I'm an ambassador in chains. Now, this is what I want to close with. You know, when you think of an ambassador, you think of someone who is traveling the world to be representative of a nation or an institution. That's what an ambassador does. Ambassadors travel the world to be representatives of that which they represent, that which they come from, a nation, a state, an institution, an entity. They are ambassadors. But Paul says, Pastor, I'm an ambassador, but I'm in chains. How can you function, Pastor Kemper, as an ambassador in chains? How are you able to move without moving? How can you operate beyond the confines of the sanctuary walls without ever leaving the sanctuary walls? It's because when you are in submission to God, He can take that which puts limitations on you, and He can render that something that does not hinder you, because God is not limited by what we are limited by. He can take the pastor's word, the pastor's witness, the pastor's message, and He can let that shine forth. And I close because Paul said, I'm an ambassador in chains. He said, I'm in submission to Christ, that I preach, I teach, I live, I may die. I'm an ambassador. I'm submitted to the Lord Jesus Christ. And our greatest example is not even Paul. Because the only reason Paul could say that he was an ambassador is because he knew someone who exemplified what that meant. Because if you remember, Jesus did nothing that he was not in submission while he was doing it. He was in submission to his Father every step of the way, because the Bible says that the Spirit of God led him into the wilderness. And he endured temptation and testing because he had to be approved by his Father before he could announce his ministry to the world. The Bible says that he then exercised power over affliction and animosity because he was in agreement with his Father. He said, I and the Father are one. I don't do anything without the Father's permission. And then he embraced the high cost of Calvary, because the Bible says that in his Garden of Gethsemane, he prayed to God, asked him three times, let this cup pass. But nevertheless, he said, let your will, not mine, be done. And the shout of it all is that after he endured this cross, after he endured the horrors of the cross, and he was stuck and endured the darkness of that tomb, we all know that he walked out of the tomb and he made his exit because he was now alive after he had been dead, and he ascended to the Father, and he now sits at the right hand, and he's waiting on that day when he shall return once and for all as the reigning redeemer of all of humanity, because that is our gospel message, and that is the power by which your pastor preaches. And so today, I want to end with this. I want you to understand that your pastor needs your prayers. Your pastor needs your prayers. Your pastor needs your prayers. And here's what I want you to also realize. He doesn't need your prayers because something's wrong. The pastor and his wife and his family, they don't always need your prayers because something's not right. They simply need your prayers so that God can continue to give them strength, to give him wisdom, to give him clarity, to give him vision and direction, so that Mount Pilgrim can continue to be the successful and vibrant church that thrives in this awesome community. And so I close by saying, pray for your pastor, pray for his wife, pray for his family, and thank God that you have a partnership, that God has brought all of you all together, and that Mount Pilgrim has so many more things in store, because prayer, believe it or not your suit, not your hairdo, not your eyeglasses, not your wallet, not your resume or your references, but prayer really makes it all possible. Congratulations, Pastor. Congratulations, pastoral family. Congratulations, Mount Pilgrim. Prayer, if you keep praying, we'll continue to make it all possible. God bless you.
Good morning. Thank you, Reverend Virginia, for a powerful sermon. Pastor,
We are praying for you daily. There's not one day go by that we don't pray for you and your family. We just thank God for all that you have done for Mount Pilgrim and all that you will do for Mount Pilgrim through the strength of God that he's using you in a mighty, powerful way. So, Pastor, would you mind coming up a little bit, please? Deacons, those who are here, come up, please. Deacon, those who are up. It's been 4 years. What a journey it has been. Having you, Pastor, as our pastor. I remember when you first was elected to pastor. But what's the word you say? I don't want to say this right this morning, but what's happening? But we have been on the journey, Pastor, for 4 years, and you have brought us a mighty long ways. Thank you for all the work you have done for my pilgrim. And on behalf of the officers and the members of Mount Pilgrim Baptist Church, we'd like to offer you this little token of appreciation. Just a token for what you have done. And this is from my family to you. Sister Kemper, Ayanna, Ellis, come up, please. Here we have the Kemper family, the first family of Mount Pilgrim Baptist Church. Sister Aurelia, I want to say thank you for your leadership, for guiding your husband where you do. Ellis, thank you. Ayanna, thank you. You guys have done so much since you guys have been at Mount Pilgrim. So we appreciate you guys too. But the officers and the members have something for you guys. We would like to present to you a vacation to Washington, D.C. on behalf of my pilgrim, officers, and members. So you take this trip, enjoy yourself to Washington, D.C. Guests love you guys. Thank you.
Pastor Kemper and the Kemper family, we are so blessed to have you all here with us. We have been excited since you've been here. The church has been moving forward. We've been doing great things. And every time the pastor is here, his family is here with him. All the work that we were doing at the Rock Center, the donations, making an impact in the community, helping people that needed it, they were here with you every time. So was I, by the way. But we just want to bless you and thank you all so much for y'all's service, not only to Mount Pilgrim, but to the community of Lake Charles. So thank you, and I want to give you a personal gift from my family to your family, and I hope you guys enjoy it. God bless you.
Come on, let's give God an offering of praise. Amen. Amen. Can we give Pastor Williams an offering of praise for that powerful, powerful word? Have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy. I tell God thank you for my brother and my friend. And Doc, you know that friendship, it means so much to me. It really does. It means so much to me. And I know because of the pandemic and things like that, we keep trying to hit and miss. But I know that I can call you. I know that we can have those really deep, deep conversations. Amen. And I tell God, thank you that we don't have to compete. We're brothers, we're friends, we're partners in ministry, and I just tell God thank you for that. Amen. And so I just give God praise for that word. I was definitely encouraged. Amen. And I want to say thank you to our deacon brothers. It's a privilege to lead with you. It's a privilege to lead with you. Each and every one of you I can call, pick your brain for wisdom, even in our meetings. You know, sometimes... Pilgrim, I want to tell you that because you see what you see on the outside is what we present to you, the deacons and the trustees. We present ideas and plans to you, and that's what you see. But what you don't see is behind the scenes, we discuss, we disagree, we present different points of view. But when we come out, we recognize we're brothers. We are co-laborers and co-leaders together of this church. And I know that the hand of God is upon Pilgrim. And one of the ways that I know that is because he has given me the trustees and the deacons of this church to serve with. Amen. And so I just tell God, thank you for you. And I give God an offering of praise for every deacon and trustee in this church. Amen. It's such a blessing to be able to lead with brothers. Amen. And then I will be remiss to not stop by saying or close by saying to my family that I love you, right? Ellis, Iyana, Maria. I know it's not easy. I know it's not easy, right? But what I've discovered over these years is that God has given me a tremendous gift in my family. And my wife, she is a tremendous gift. Sometimes y'all just don't know some of them points that in my sermon, you know, they be way a whole lot more complicated than what they come out. But I always filter my complicated thoughts through the practical wisdom of my wife. Sister girl got practical wisdom. Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you? And she'll be like, "You saying that too complicated, real? You need to say that. You need to say that more simpler than that, baby." And I'll be like, "What do you think about this? What do you think about these words?" And by the time Sunday comes, she done help me filter this complicated mess in my head. She's helped me filter that joint down so anybody can pick it up. Amen. And I just tell God, thank you for that. Any idea, I can share with her, and she can, and God gives her such discernment and such wisdom. God has given me a wise wife. Amen. And I'm grateful for that. Amen. Because she sees what very few people get a chance to see, and that is what Pastor Al was talking about, the burden, the weight, right? But I tell God, thank you that she shares that burden and that weight with me. Amen. And I just tell God, thank you for them. Amen. And so before we close, I want to just say to anyone who's watching on today that perhaps you clicked on this video by chance. You didn't know what you were clicking on, but you started watching, and somehow your attention has gotten arrested. And you've watched this whole video up until this moment right now. Well, I believe that somehow, some way, the Spirit of God works like that. And perhaps you're watching this video simply for this moment right now. And that is that God wants to save you right where you are. Can I tell you, you don't have to be in a physical sanctuary. There is no special place or even not even a special posture that you have to be in order for the Lord to save you. But here's what the Bible says. The Bible says that no man comes to the Father unless he draws them. And you clicking on this video right now is God's way of drawing you to him. And here's what the Bible says. The Bible says that if you will confess with your mouth, listen to me, what this means. This means that this means you're confessing that you're a sinner, and you know there's no way within your own strength that you can be right with God. There is nothing you can do, past too jacked up, present too uncertain, tomorrow too uncertain. The Bible says this, that if you will simply confess that the work was done by Jesus at Calvary, the Bible says this, that he will save you right where you are. In that living room, in that kitchen, God can save you right there. And I want to tell your family that if you will surrender to God, God promises you that in this moment you shall be saved, and your eternity will be secure. God will fill you with his Spirit, and he will set your life on a new trajectory. So you can surrender right now. My brother, my sister, right where you are, just surrender to God. In fact, I want you to click on that website there on your screen. There's a place on our website that says, "I want to know more about Jesus."
We've laid out so many scriptures and all of the things that you hear, Christians say so many times that you may not understand what it means. There's so many scriptures to help you understand that. But then at the bottom of that page, there's a link where you can reach out to us. And I want to tell you that one of our deacons or even myself will call you personally and we'll help you and answer the questions that you may have. Perhaps sometime in the future we can baptize you. There's another tab there that says, I want to be a part of your church. I want to join your church. You can do the same thing. There's questions and answers there. There's a form you can fill out, and you can submit that form, and we'll be in contact with you to tell you more about Pilgrim. We love to be your family, and I'd love to be your pastor. Well, Mount Pilgrim, I love you so much. I tell God thank you for each and every one of you. To our praise team, to our musicians, y'all my peoples, man, right? love y'all so much. May God bless you and may God keep you. Would you receive now your blessing? The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you. The Lord be gracious to you. The Lord give you peace. In the very name of Christ Jesus, our Lord, we pray. My Heavenly Father's children said, amen. God bless you.
Come on, put your hands together. Let's give God glory in here tonight. Hallelujah.
He goes into action. Anybody here want to give God some praise for going into action on your behalf? That you don't have. God is not asking you to work in a season that you are not in yet. God is asking us to use the time we have, the resources we have, the abilities we have in the seasons that we have. Somebody say it right now.
I almost lost my mind, but I made it.
I made it.
Yes, I did.
He left the sheep on his shoulders and he carries the sheep. I wonder if there's anybody here that's ever been carried by God.